So we will do the intro offline, just to in terms of like your bio. Welcome back to the Food Code. We are so excited for another interview today to bring you more expertise in different areas. And today we have Alexandria DeVito, who is a functional nutritionist and specializes in fertility, specifically preconception health, which I love because I think a lot of people think that getting pregnant should be easy, seamless, their baby should be healthy, and they shouldn't have to do anything about it. And our bodies are amazing, but sometimes they could use a little bit more help and specifics around that. So thank you for joining us, Alexandria. We are so excited to have you. Tell us a little bit about how you got into this area.
Thank you so much for having me. And I think you already summarized a lot of my philosophy in, you know, T-minus 30 seconds. So, so I was a consultant, corporate consultant for about most of my early career. I worked in healthcare consulting and worked with a lot of pharmaceutical companies, med device companies, so kind of learned the healthcare world from that space. Knew that, you know, I was really fascinated by healthcare, but I felt like I wanted to switch from what I felt was a more reactive model of healthcare to a more proactive one. And that was the impetus to go back to school. So I went back and got my MBA from Harvard. And then I also did a master's in nutrition on the side while I was doing my MBA. And then I went and worked in clinical practice, which, you know, was really important for me to be on the front lines with clients one-on-one. I think, you know, there's a lot we can see from the 1,000-foot view, but there's a lot more that we can see when we have humans in front of us and we can see the things that they're struggling with. And what happened next really surprised me, which was I had a lot of clients that were coming to me who were struggling to conceive. And they were a year into their fertility journey, 2 years, 3 years, and I was one of the last stops on the train where they were coming and saying, we don't know what to do, I've tried all the things, and I have no idea why we're having trouble, and do you have any suggestions? And at the time, I was just really struck by this. Like, this seems like a really important question, seems like a solvable problem. What is happening here? And this was also happening personally, like over coffee and over drinks. Friends would just grab me and like whisper in my ear, hey, like, can I get your quick perspective on something? Same thing. I'm trying, I'm willing to do anything, but nobody can tell me what to do. And I was really just struck by this. So I, you know, do what I do best, which is research. I just like dove into the clinical literature. I was doing my functional medicine certification at the time. So I was learning about body systems and detective work and not treating all diagnoses as the same. And through that whole process, I realized, wow, you know, we plan for every other major milestone in life, weddings, careers, there's a checklist for every single one of them. There's infrastructure and support. And there's not the same thing for fertility. And why is that? Why are we not giving people the same level of support and information about their own bodies? And why do we have to wait to find out about someone's health until they try to conceive? So I realized that you can move it up. And so you can test, fertility doesn't have to be a black box, and you can test early on and get some indicators. And is it perfect? No. But can we know more about what's going on in your body than if we weren't looking at it? Yes, we can. So that's been kind of the journey to building what is now my company, Poplin, and then writing a book about it, which I'm sure we'll get into, and just trying to share this with as many people as I possibly can.
Yeah, I think it's really, really important. I mean, in our line of work, obviously, you know, we work with women and we do have a couple practitioners on staff that work with fertility. But when you think about the conventional space, they basically talk about, hey, are you taking a prenatal? Right? That's literally the only thing I have ever been asked. Like, are you taking your prenatal? Are you taking folic acid? And there's no emphasis on, is the person in even a healthy space to conceive, right? Like, is their blood sugar balanced, or are they coming in, you know, already dysregulated, inflamed, overweight, malnourished, right? All of those things. And then I think there's a large disservice, which we'll, I'm sure, talk about too, in terms of how do you fuel your body once you do get pregnant, right? Because we're craving all these carbohydrates, but how do we balance that out? I know, you know, obviously the book Real Foods for Pregnancy is great, and she talks a lot about, you know, the importance of protein and things in there, but also what happens preconception, right? Like, and so I appreciate this, and I'm excited for this conversation because we've had conversations with other practitioners in the past where we're saying to people, above all, before you're going to get pregnant is the time to work on your health, your gut health, right? And get nourished 6 months at least prior. And same for your husband or, you know, whoever you're conceiving with. So we know that you're one of the few preconception experts in the world. So can you just describe what a preconception expert is and what about this role makes it so important? Because I know it, the importance of it, but I'm sure many people are still like, I'm taking my prenatal, I'm fine. I'll get pregnant. It'll happen.
Oh my gosh, there are so many juicy nuggets in there. I think, yeah, so I think the way I think about it is preconception is the period of time, the roughly 1 year window, although theoretically it can be much, you know, much longer, before pregnancy and between pregnancy. So one thing I also say is this is not just for first time parents. This is for first time parents, fifth time parents, right? And whether you're 23 or you're 45, you know, it applies in all cases and potentially because of some of the things I know you all talk about on this podcast, you may be in an even more nutrient depleted state after a previous pregnancy. You may be even more sleep deprived. You may be even more hormonally imbalanced after a first pregnancy and first child, and managing all of the demands that come with that. So, you know, preconception is really about how do we prepare our bodies, as you said, to increase the probability of getting pregnant and having a healthy pregnancy and baby. And that happens in this kind of 3, 6, 12 month window prior. And, you know, I'm sure we'll talk about all the components, but it just practically speaking, you cannot give a baby that which you do not have yourself, right? And I think that's a broad principle. And so in even the first trimester of pregnancy, we are pulling from the nutrition stores of what was eaten in the previous, you know, trimester or premester, right? The previous roughly 3 months or so. And so if we're not actually replete during those periods of time, then that's where you start to see challenges with not only mom's energy, but also the development of the baby. And so really, pregnancy is the most nutrient intensive time in a woman's entire life. It's like running back to back to back marathons. And so, right, I like to think of it as fueling as such, right? Fueling for it as if it's an athletic event. And I know, I imagine that resonates, right? So there is, you know, we can talk about diet in a lot of different ways. I'm a big proponent of thinking about not diet as a what are we removing, although that can be part of the conversation, but, you know, what are we adding and how can we optimize versus how are we trying to avoid all the bad things that can happen? And how do we think about nutrient density in this period of time?
Yeah. I so wish that OBGYNs would talk about this with patients rather than just monitoring their weight. That's one thing that has been very, very angering for me in terms of just clients and, you know, family members, loved ones, friends, where they're just constantly managing the weight. And I'm like, this is not the time to be worried about your weight. You are growing a human, which is a miracle and miraculous. You need that nourishment. You need that fuel, like you mentioned, and that energy. So thank you for touching on that, because anybody out there who's pregnant or looking to conceive, like, wait, your body's going to do what it needs to do to make that baby strong and healthy if it's, you know, nourished.
Yeah. And I see a lot, unfortunately, where females are worried that they are gaining too much weight and then they will not nourish themselves as well. And then in turn, they're not nourishing baby as well. And I have transparently not actually looked into research on this, but I've heard multiple times around how one of the only glands that babies are born fully developed with are adrenals, and how if the mother is struggling to nourish herself or not taking care of herself stress-wise, she will actually feed off of baby's adrenals, which leads to higher rates of allergies and autoimmune disorders and other things for baby once they are born. And so I don't know if you've ever read into that or heard anything about that, but I've heard that multiple times. So I'd imagine in my mind, it makes it true.
Crowdsourcing. I haven't heard that specific example. But what I have heard that is very related to that was when I was doing my master's in nutrition, there was one class, even like one passage that just like completely changed my view of nutrition. And it was a book called Nutrition Through the Life Cycle. And it talked about the fetus, in this case, the fetus is not a parasite. And I was like, tell me more. What exactly do you mean by that? And I think the traditional knowledge is, oh, well, you know, if I'm eating decently, right, the food will go to baby first and then to me. Because as parents, right, once the babies are born, oftentimes that's how we act, is we prioritize our child's needs over our own. But that is not biologically what happens, right? Just like on a plane where they say, put your oxygen mask on first, because otherwise, like, if you're not well, then you can't help anyone else. Your body actually puts your nutrients on first. And there are actually studies of this where if a mom is undernourished, at, you know, like you and tries to feed themselves to address a nutrient deficiency, whether that's through food or through supplementation, there are plenty of cases where mom gets replete, but the baby is not. And so I think that's just really important. And this is, again, you know, like, no judgment on anyone, right? But just knowing these things can be helpful, because that's why I say it's really important. There's, you know, there could be a time for fat loss, but pregnancy is not one of them.
Yeah. And I wouldn't say postpartum if you're breastfeeding as well.
Great point. Great point.
Very energy expensive to the body, and those nutrients are so important. And we know, Beck and I have been there. I've only been there once. She's been there a few times, but we know that you want to get back to feeling like yourself. But it's also, you know, we say, give yourself a year, give yourself some grace. Again, it's a miraculous event, you know, to be able to grow a healthy child. So what would you say? I mean, right now we know there's a lot of anxiety, and you know, infertility rates are higher than they've ever been. What do you think is the single most important thing that someone can do to enhance their fertility and increase the likelihood of them having a healthy child?
Oh, that's such an elegant question. I think what I would say is shift your mindset from one where your biological age is the biggest predictor, your chronological age is the biggest predictor of fertility, to one where your biological age is a better predictor of fertility. And I will explain that more. So what I think most females have been told, at least for the last decade or two, is that once you turn, take your pick, depending on where you live, 30, 35, you turn into a pumpkin, too bad, so sad for you. So that sucks. Can't do anything about it, right? And not only is that incredibly disempowering, it is also not scientifically true. And so, you know, we have a lot more science now to understand that there is a big difference for most people between their chronological age, meaning their age in years, and their biological age, like the vitality of their cells. And we can't yet chronologically age backwards, meaning, you know, we are the amount of years that we have been present on this earth. However, we are understanding that there are a lot of things that you can do to modify your biological age. And that's a lot of the things that you talk about: diet and movement and stress management and managing your environmental toxin load, your relationships. All of these things change the cellular structures in a positive or negative way. And so I think I would not let, as long as you are still cycling, there is an opportunity to improve your fertility. And I would not let anyone tell you otherwise. And so I think that shift alone, and understanding that you have so much more agency over your reproductive health than you may have been led to believe, is the single domino that I think affects all the rest.
I would 100% agree. I believe that we've had even conversations. There are certain tribes where women get pregnant at the age of, I think, 50 or 60 years old.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it has a lot to do with not age, like you said, but the vitality. I always joke that, and one of our mentors has always said, like, I want to ask God what he was thinking with menopause. Like, to me, the only logical way is, like, vitality wise at that point in your life, it is harder to care for small children. Energy is lower, you know, you're reaching a higher age, but there are women that get pregnant at that age, and you should be able to, too. You know, they are not complete anomalies. It is probably because they have taken care of their body in certain ways. They have done certain things, and their body feels safe enough to conceive, right? And I think that's another big thing, that that anxiety piece, right? That fear of being able to get pregnant or not being able to get pregnant, and how much the nervous system and our emotions around the situation can affect that, because an unsafe body is not going to get pregnant. It is not going to feel that it is the right environment to foster a baby. So I think in that sense, my question would be, what other benefits, aside from the ease of mind of planning for a pregnancy, you know, because when you're planning for something and preparing for something, it usually eases anxiety to an extent, right? You know, we always say, like, action is the solution to anxiety, because now you have a plan. Now you have, it's not just, oh, I don't know why. It's, I am doing these things specifically. So I would say, what are the biggest benefits, and how do you cross between being completely nonchalant about it, which I don't think is the right answer, or very militant and timing your sex and timing, you know, all of these things that you and your spouse do, which just gets, I've been in that place before too, because I actually conceived my first through IVF. And I didn't have a period for 3 years because I overtrained and underate and competed in CrossFit for far too long. So I knew the reason why I couldn't have a period and conceive, right? We just went straight to IVF because at that time I didn't know, but doing IVF, you know, the having to have sex at this time and then having to elevate your pelvis on a pillow to make sure that the sperm didn't fall out. Like it was, you know,
super sexy,
so enjoyable. And so what would you say, how do you recommend kind of bridging that gap? And then what do you think are some of the big benefits of preparing for a pregnancy?
Oh gosh. Okay. I'm just taking a few notes to myself because there were like a couple of things in there that I think are so important that you hit on. So first, let's talk about the anxiety piece, how to address anxiety, and then why, right? Why even bother with this and how to walk this balance? So the way I talk about it is that reproductive anxiety, i.e. the anxiety that we feel when thinking about getting pregnant, sustaining a pregnancy, or having a healthy baby, has gone up meaningfully. And usually, anytime we have anxiety, it's because there is a disconnect between the level of importance of something and our control over that situation, right? So pregnancy, getting pregnant, building a family for many people is high importance. Like this is really, really on the top of my list of things that are meaningful to me in my life. And we've been told there's nothing you can do, like to the point earlier, right? Just take a prenatal vitamin, cross your fingers, hope it works, throw some stuff at the wall, see if it sticks, right? Like, I mean, these are genuinely the things that are shared. It's bonkers. And so a thinking person would say, okay, like that feels like a real conundrum because I really care, but I'm told I can't do anything about it. And so I think this is where your point gets in, which is like, there's tons of things that you can do about it. Can we control every piece of the process? No, that's not life, right? But can we control a lot more of it than we've been told? And, you know, are there, can we, if we manage the inputs, do we increase the probability of getting the outputs that we desire? Yes. Does it work 100% of the time? Absolutely not, right? So this is where I think taking action is helpful. And I think it becomes harder when you just are sitting there or you're just trying month after month and everyone's saying, you're fine. There's nothing wrong, right? And by the way, there is nothing wrong with you. But like, it is so patronizing and so heartbreaking. And I sat across from many, many, many clients who were told this and they're like, no, something is off. Even if it's not wrong, something is off. And you know, you even shared your experience saying, well, I know now kind of what that was for me. So I think, you know, there is just an invitation to think about this a little bit differently, right? Your body will always prioritize survival over procreation, right? And so as you were saying, anytime it feels it's an unsafe or resource constrained environment, it will downregulate reproductive function. And our modern lives scream war and famine all day long, right? Like we're eating food, but we're starving for real nutrients. We're, you know, constantly in situations that are triggering our fight or flight. And so our body thinks, oh, okay, not a great time to be procreating right now. And so it downregulates reproductive function. So just understanding those principles are important. And then the last thing I will say on this, you know, in terms of what you're asking about balance, because you're asking about this question around like laissez-faire or militant. And I saw that all the time. People either are like, you know, can't control it. So why am I going to even bother? Or I'm going to do all the things. I'm going to put together the spreadsheet with all the prenatal vitamins and I'm going to compare all the nutrients, right? And I get it. I'm a spreadsheet girl myself. So I understand. But how do we walk this balance of let's do the things that we know can matter. And then we're going to have to let go of the rest at some point, right? You do what you can and then you're, and that's true in nutrition. That's true in life. And by the way, like, I think that's also true in parenting, right? You control what you can control and then, let go of the rest.
you try to control more and they don't let you control more.
They surprise you sometimes. They surprise you with all the, sometimes I have no idea where things come from in parenting. I was telling Liz that my husband walked in with, totally off tangent, but my husband walked in on my son peeing the other day while he was getting ready for bath. He's 5. And he was singing, I don't know if you've heard Chamillionaire, Riding Dirty song, but he was going, they see me rolling, they hating, they're trying to catch me. And my husband was like, where did you hear that song? And he watches these lip sync videos of cops, and cops do lip sync challenges. And so they're always like doing, and so then he asks me, Mom, what does ride and dirty mean? And I was like,
oh no,
you're speeding. I don't know. It's, I
don't know. Quick on the uptake. Pretty good.
I explain drugs to my child. He understands speeding, but he does not. So getting thrown into situations constantly of children and parenting and, you know, the joys that you never realize as you're trying to conceive of what you will actually experience in the next phase of parenting. Oh my goodness. So sorry for the tangent. It was just,
it's okay.
The best, it's all right. Best experiences as a parent.
So, you know, I love that you mentioned there the level of importance of something and then our control over it. I think that's so true. Yes. In terms of anxiety for a lot of people. And I think the best thing that we can maybe take here is to say, there is so much that you are in control of, such as your diet, right? Your stress management, maybe not all the stressors, but how you're managing and trying to become more resilient and create that, you know, central nervous system safetiness, right? Like the signaling that I am safe. And then, you know, really making sure as you are preparing for pregnancy that, yes, you are nourished, right? And you have good quality food, adequate protein, like choline, you know, antioxidants, anti-inflammatories, fish oil, all of that stuff. So you mentioned in your book, like prepare for pregnancy the way you would a wedding. Mm-hmm. And I'm just going to say, I did not enjoy wedding planning. When we were done, I was like, ooh, I got a part-time job, you know, time frame back here, because it's just, it's a lot of work. And so can you explain a little bit what you mean by that when you say, you know, kind of prepare like you're planning for a wedding?
Yeah. So I'm a big fan of this like unique combination between ancient wisdom and modern science. And how do we leverage kind of what we've seen from our ancestors that's worked well? And like, how do we tap into what we're learning today about health and longevity? And what's interesting is that so many ancient cultures actually had preconception rituals. Where, like, one example that's talked about in the book Deep Nutrition is that the Maasai tribes would basically only let a couple marry after the wet season, after they had been eating all of this nutritious milk, drinking this nutritious milk from the grasses that were eaten by the cows over this wet season, because it's more nutrient dense. They didn't know specifically, scientifically, why that was that they were doing it, but they knew that it created healthier, sturdier children. And so that's just like one example, and there are many of these. And now we have the science to explain epigenetics, and we have the science to understand nutrient deficiencies and nutrient repletion and how that can affect later stages. So I think that gives us wisdom to say, okay, to your point, whether you enjoyed wedding planning or not, I think it's what I envision is basically in the future, everyone is going to prepare to get pregnant like we would prepare to a wedding. You wouldn't, most people wouldn't rock up to their wedding and like never having picked a location or a band or, you know, all of these details that we think about. Most people wouldn't walk up to a marathon never having run a mile before, right? We have all these other things that we treat with as if it's, you know, this big undertaking. And I think culturally we've lost that anchoring that preconception is one of those things that we can be including, because right now it's either contraception or pregnancy. Like we've forgotten this intervening period. It's all like, we don't want to get pregnant, don't want to get pregnant, don't want to get, and then all of a sudden flip a switch and like, I want to be pregnant yesterday. And like, why isn't this not happening fast enough, right? And our minds can make that switch pretty quickly. Our bodies, maybe not so much. And so it's this intervening period that, by the way, like we've had clinical guidelines for preconception for over 40 years, like that every woman should be getting a preconception visit, that there should be questions that are asked in advance, that we should be, you know, changing medications if that's particularly relevant, making sure that, you know, the body is in a replete state, taking prenatal vitamins, all of that. But somehow it's not being filtered through. Less than 20% of females are actually even offered a preconception visit. So I think there's a big cultural shift here. And so I envision a world where we all prepare in advance. And the book kind of goes through this, which is like, what's the checklist for preconception, like the checklist for a wedding? And there's kind of, here are all the, you know, the main steps that are going to be relevant for most people's journey. And then, of course, as with every wedding, there's bio-individualization, right? Like, I want to get married on a beach versus I want to get married on a farm. I want a small wedding versus I want a big wedding, right? You can take the basis of it and then customize it for yourself if you're managing chronic conditions, or, you know, if you and your partner decide that you, you know, have, like, want to do genetic testing versus not genetic testing, right? There's all sorts of things that you can customize, but even just knowing what the heck is on the menu is a starting point.
Yeah. I think too, even for, and maybe this is covered in the book or, you know, something that you could do in the future, but like the birth plan, like I had a doula who was very helpful and I had no clue at, you know, the beginning of all of that, like what all my options were, right? Mm-hmm. To either have a delayed bath, delayed cord clamping, like all of this different stuff. And I was like, wow, this is amazing, because I feel like most people just go in and they just follow what the doctors tell them to do and, you know, you're out of there, or that there's other options too in terms of birthing centers and so forth. So maybe there should be a checklist for that too, like when you're going through the birth plan. And, you know, I think, you know, you mentioned here like the anxiety around infertility and the rise in infertility. Let's talk a little bit more about that age. So we know, I mean, at least here in Illinois, I know at least just with my OB practice, after the age of 35, you're considered high risk. Or they basically tell you that your fertility chances, you know, declines after 35. So do you align with that? Where does that come from? Is it true? What are your thoughts?
Well, I have lots of feelings about this. We'll start with that. So I think what I would say is the older you are in years, the more your health matters. Let's start with that principle. The second principle I would say is as long as you are still cycling, you can improve your fertility. That's number two. And then number three is that fertility is more, fertility is an extension of your overall health, and therefore your biological health, which is what we were talking about earlier, is a better predictor of fertility than your chronological age, right? And so I think, yes, we've gotten all of these messages around infertility, but quite frankly, most of them are bullshit. Like, this is kind of what infuriated me, is because I think we have a lot of languaging, even in this space, that is blatantly wrong. So if we just take deconstruction of words for a second, which sounds incredibly pedantic, but I think it's important. Infertility means, in the popular lexicon, not fertile, right? Anytime you put in front of a word, it means not. Like, incompetent means not competent, right? Therefore, right, we're telling a bunch of women that they are not fertile. But if you actually look, all that infertility diagnosis means is I have been unable to conceive after a year of concerted trying, or 6 months if you happen to be over 35. That does not talk at all about your capacity to conceive at all. And to what you were saying earlier, right, like there's the capacity to conceive potentially at way later years than we even believe. So why is that true? These mythical, magical creatures that all of a sudden can do that? No, I would contend, right, environmentally, right, they're living in a different milieu, and they also haven't been told the mind virus that you can't conceive, right? So I think we have to deal in the realities of, yes, there are biological realities, and today, right, although some of the science on this is changing, we understand that fertility declines with age, but it is not only a factor of age. It's correlative. It's not causative. And it also does not just like fall off a cliff magically at 35. That's just not true. That's not what the data says. And if you look at any of the studies that talk about this, there is a 4% difference between someone who is conceiving even just in their early 30s versus their late 30s. That's it, 4%. It's not like tenfold, it's not 100-fold, it's not this whole, you know, nonsense that we're told. And even a woman who is in her early 40s, on average, has over 10,000 eggs left. Now let's do a little math lesson for everyone, right? And again, this is like sassy, but how many eggs does it take to get pregnant? Right? Like, you know, so at every stage, egg quality and sperm quality is going to be more important than egg quantity. So I think there is, I think it's important, right, that we just think about the cultural shifts, which is, okay, people are having children later in life. And so how can we be thoughtful about our planning? And if we want to have, you know, multiple children, how can we be thoughtful about what that looks like? I think all of those are really important questions. If it's not clear, right, I read an entire book about planning. So I'm a big fan of planning. And I also think, like, let's stop scaring the shit out of people, and let's stop giving them misinformation that is disempowering them. And so how do we walk this balance of understanding what's going on in your unique body? And this is why I'm a big fan of testing, because not all 30-year-olds are created equal. Not all 35-year-olds are created equal. And we can see what's going on for you uniquely, and we can layer that on your own priorities. And then we can come up with, okay, what's the plan that's relevant for you?
Yeah. What are some of your favorite tests? So when you were in, you know, clinical practice working with individuals, what are the first things that you're looking at?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think the way that I constructed our, like, the test that we run at Poplin, which is the company that I founded, was thinking about, okay, fertility is an extension of our overall health. So historically we look at, we treat fertility as a below the waist conversation. Like, you know, it's just that, and like, and maybe it's your hormones, right? But like, true, but you know, but not the full story. Right. And so, what I think about is, okay, well, if your sex hormones are dysregulated, let's say, they're the most downstream thing. They're downstream of your thyroids. They're downstream of your adrenal. So if your sex hormones are low, let's just say, we have no idea why, right? Is it because your thyroid function is off? Is it because your adrenals are off? And I was working in New York City for many, many years. And for many people, it started with the adrenals, right? And you were talking about this earlier, right? Like, if your adrenals are dysfunctioning, right? If we just pump you with sex hormones, that doesn't address the underlying problem. And so we can circumvent it, but then you're still left feeling like crap, and you're still missing out on this top level. So, you know, my philosophy on this is, okay, how do we look at the body system? And right, that includes your blood status. So, you know, I know you've talked CBC and CMP, right? You know, and understanding, like, if iron is low, like, the number of people that are coming to us with low iron status is bananas. And it's easy to measure, and it's easy to address once you know it, right? Then we look at metabolic status, right? So blood sugar function, and not just blood sugar, but also insulin. Insulin often changes many years before blood sugar function does. So looking at that, looking at nutrient deficiencies, right? We're seeing tons of vitamin D deficiency, even though I know it's a nutrient of concern and we're talking about it, we're still seeing it a lot. Looking at immune function, autoimmune conditions are on the rise, and they're disproportionately present in the female population. So, you know, that can be responsible for recurrent miscarriage. So, you know, it takes 5 years on average to get diagnosed, and five different doctors. So, you know, looking at that and uncovering that is another, you know, really important thing. So, and I think all of these are, you know, really important. So understanding blood status, hormone status, metabolic status, nutrient status, and immune status, all of these are kind of pieces of the puzzle. And then I think there's like additional things, right, that I was doing when I was working one-on-one as a clinician, like, you know, gut function testing and so forth. I think that's, you know, an incredibly important, depending on kind of what your constellation is, we might want to do further hormone testing, or we might want to do gut function testing, or we might want to understand toxin load testing, right? But starting with a screening test allows us to say, okay, like, well, what's lighting up? And then we can kind of go from there.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think another big problem is that we have very little patience in our society today. Just a little bit. And a lot of people, if they do not conceive immediately, think like, well, I'm just going to go to IVF route. And we've had a couple of people on here that have talked about IVF. I have some really, you know, I was very fortunate with our IVF experience. It was a good experience. We got very lucky that it was the first try that we got pregnant with IVF. I think because chronologically, I was not very unhealthy. I just didn't have a cycle. And so when I, you know, started getting a cycle, I think everything else was fine. Because I conceived after that naturally. But I don't love the IVF world in a lot of ways. I think that it is a little bit of it's become somewhat of a business for a lot of the clinics out there. And it's not very individualized to the people. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on, you know, if people are not getting pregnant, going immediately to IVF?
Hmm. Such a powerful question and a challenging one. Because here's what I would say. Like, I'm not, you know, I try to take the position of, I don't tell anyone what to do. What I will tell you is what the science says and what the options are. And I think we're not giving people enough informed consent, i.e. here are the options that are available to you, and here are the potentially puts and takes of each option, right? And I think what's happened is that IVF is an incredible intervention, right? It's allowed people who historically have not been able to build families to build families, whether that's same-sex couples or people who are sterile, meaning that actually physiologically cannot get pregnant, which is about 1% of the population. And so for that, I really hold reverence that, you know, it's really been an innovation that's been a gift for so many. And it's also now being used far too early and far too often for most people because it's been being presented as the only game in town. So people are being essentially offered a false dichotomy, which is do nothing or do IVF. You pick, right? That's it. Those are the only options, again, on the menu. And so if you're faced, right, if building a family is really important to you and someone says, you can just sit at home and twiddle your thumbs, or you can do IVF, you know, you can only imagine what people are going to pick. And I don't blame them. And so what I would say is, you know, there's a leading, and I quote this in my book because I think it is so wild, but there's a leading reproductive endocrinologist in New York City who says that based on his estimation, at least 50% of IVF, or maybe it's up to 50% of IVF, is unnecessary. So this is someone who's doing IVF cycles all day, every day, and is observing that is unnecessary in many cases. Okay, well, then you ask the question, well, why would it be unnecessary? Well, I think, you know, it's these cases where, okay, there's not, you know, maybe we can start the investigation of what might be off earlier. So, you know, you were talking about not getting a cycle. And so that's a very common thing, incredibly common, right? So, okay, then you say, okay, well, maybe let's ask the question, why? Right? But doctors are not asking that question most of the time. And, you know, all people that do not have a cycle, to your point, are treated exactly the same with exactly the same protocol and exactly the same diagnosis. But you put 100 people in front of me who aren't getting their cycle, there's probably 100 different reasons. Now, there are variations on probably the same 3 or 4 reasons, right? Sometimes it's overexercising and undereating, right? Undernourishment. Sometimes it's, you know, like a different, sometimes there's infections or diagnoses that they aren't aware of that are putting pressure on their adrenals, right? Your sex hormones and your stress hormones are in the same biochemical pathway. And your body, again, will always prioritize survival over procreation. So if you're, you know, marathon training or doing tons of cycling workouts, or, you know, maybe in your case, it was CrossFit workouts, right? Your body will divert resources from making your sex hormones to making stress hormones. And that's an adaptive response. And when that happens over and over, that's when you start to see some of these things, like missed periods. So then we ask the question, okay, right? I mean, I think it's an incredible story that you're talking about, which is, okay, you went through this whole process the first time and had IVF, and then the second time around you conceived naturally. So does that suggest, like, I mean, how do we explain something like that, right? Did you all of a sudden go from being infertile to being fertile? It's just a very curious question, right? So I think there's a lot here, and I feel very strongly about it. And I want to be cautious about, you know, not judging anyone for their decisions. And, you know, you make the best choices that you can make with the information that you have. And when you're only being given, you know, very limited options and you want to build your family, you do what you can. But I would just invite to say, even if you're going to go through IVF or even egg freezing for that matter, it's still important to optimize egg health. It's still important to optimize sperm health because that is what sets the stage for your child's lifelong health. So regardless of the path, whether it's natural or assisted, right, this preconception period is incredibly, incredibly powerful.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And I think, you know, I just have had some previous conversations recently with individuals and they were totally shocked to even hear that, hey, my gut microbiome impacts my child's health. And I'm like, yes, you as the mother are going to pass on all of these things. So it's really important to prepare your body for this conception, right? And then, you know, obviously help offset maybe the potential loss that might occur, you know, especially if there are infections, because, you know, there are some cases where the body does perceive that pregnancy, you know, as a parasite, and then, you know, we lose it. And so there's so many things that can come into play. And just in my experience with talking with, you know, the fertility clinic and everything, they didn't look at anything beyond just some basic, you know, lab work. They didn't talk about diet. They didn't talk about weight, blood sugar, toxins, any of those things. And so I would love to kind of, as we start to wrap up here, have you expand a little bit more on what are some of the top fertility blockers that you see? Mm-hmm. And how can people really start paying attention and removing these blocks, you know, before they maybe go down the route of seeking, you know, whether it's IVF or just other treatment. What are things they could do, start doing today in terms of those blocks to remove those barriers?
Yeah. So I want to, you know, share this next piece with sensitivity, and also in an effort to really help people understand how much they have to take action around this, which is that just like our environment is obesogenic in the sense that it is predisposing us to obesity, it is also infertilegenic, predisposing us to infertility. And what that basically means is that unless you take compensatory actions to offset just existing in the world, you are likely to experience challenges around obesity and or infertility. And that is an unfortunate reality. I wish it was not the case, but I think that's where it's important and to understand, because many of the factors that come in play are like kind of just part of our culture. It's just kind of part of our existence. And so you have, it's kind of a radical act sometimes to say, no, I opt out of some of these things to, in service of myself. Also, again, to the point earlier, without driving ourselves crazy, right? So walking this line. So the big ones that I see are certainly around nutrition. And what I mean by that is that like the diets that are supportive of fertility are not necessarily the diets that are the trendy ones. And actually many popular diets are not very aligned for fertility. Sure. And so, right, I mean, you were talking about protein earlier and so forth. Like, and I think that what I say to people is, if you're happy with your diet, I'm happy with your diet. If you are getting signals that it's not working for you, then maybe it's time to reevaluate. And what might have been appropriate at a different stage of your life may not be appropriate for this stage of life, right? And so there is, like, you know, we talk a lot about ketogenic diets, for example. I think ketogenic diets can be incredibly effective therapeutic diets, and there are populations for which they do very well on them. However, right, carbohydrates can be very important to restore a cycle, to keep a cycle. And so for a lot of people, that doesn't actually work from a hormone regulation standpoint. And again, it's individualistic, but these are things that I see, like over time, people have, you know, been on a ketogenic diet for a while and they're not getting their cycles anymore, as an example, right? Vegan and vegetarian diets, similarly, right? I think, again, there is the biological decision and then there is, you know, the personal decision on that. And again, I will not tell anyone how to eat, but when we think about it, almost, you know, all of the diets for fertility are very, very nutrient dense, and all of our hormones are made from saturated fat, which is coming from animal products. And so, you know, just thinking about, okay, like, is my cycle where it needs to be? And am I ovulating on a regular basis? And do I feel like I'm getting appropriate nutrition? Because certain nutrients are more bioavailable in animal forms than in plant forms. So just taking all of these things into consideration, right? Like kind of the diet for fertility, it's like eat as if you're already pregnant. The diet for fertility is very similar to kind of what we would say. The diet is in pregnancy and even, you know, that much more nutrient dense. And so very, very nutrient dense, is a big piece of it. So I think nutrition is like one big bucket that I would talk about. Do you want me to pause there? Or do you want me to share the next?
I would share anything else. In okay. Terms of
yeah. And then I would say stress, we've talked a bunch about. Stress is a big one, right? And like, it's not helpful to say stress, right? Because then people get stressed about being stressed and it's like one big cascade and like, that's no fun, right? And like, has it ever been helpful for someone to say, don't stress? Like, thanks. Thank you, Captain Obvious. Like, okay. However, understanding the physiology behind it, I think, is important, which is, right, what we were talking about earlier, that sex hormones and stress hormones are in the same biochemical pathway. So you usually have two options here. For any stressors that you have a choice about, get rid of them. Like chronic stressors that you have a choice about. It's not acute stressors. Like, you know, if it happens and it passes, that's, our bodies were designed for that. It's the all day, every day, constant stuff, right? Living in a moldy home, right? That's a constant stressor, for example. Going to a job that you really, really, really do not like, that is a constant stressor. So those sorts of things, if you have a choice over it, then remove it. If you do not have a choice over it, like sometimes we can't move out of the house that we're in, right? Then do whatever you can to change your relationship to that stress or manage that stress, right? And so like, I'll give a simple example, which is, you know, not in the moldy home, but if you're in a home that you don't like, or in a city that you are not excited about, how can you upgrade the environment that you're in so that when you enter it, it feels comforting to you and safe to you and exciting? And like, you don't have to spend a ton of money necessarily to do that. So, you know, that's how I think about managing the stressors. And then the last piece I will touch on, because we haven't spent a ton of time on this, is just environmental toxin load, which sounds scary and overwhelming, but it's real. And like, we're running a huge epidemiological study on our entire population that nobody opted into, right? We're dousing ourselves in chemicals, right? And it's coming in water and food and air and personal care products and home care products. And like, you're never going to live a toxin-free life. It is not possible. Our bodies do naturally detoxify, but certainly not at the rate and pace that we are being exposed to things. So as much as possible, reducing your own exposures to these things so that the inevitable stuff that you are going to be exposed to that you can't manage, your body can handle it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And supporting those detoxification pathways as much as you possibly can. You know, whether that's through liver support, liver-loving foods, binders, a variety of things, right?
Oh, yes. Love the liver.
Yes. Yeah. You got to love the liver. Liver and lymph. You gotta love your lymph system too, right? Yeah. Because a lot of the stuff can get stuck there. So this is really, really helpful. Share a little bit about your book, if you don't mind, and just talk a little bit about, you know, I love that you mentioned 9 months is not enough. That's the title of her book. So obviously it's a pre-pregnancy checklist and baby ready body to build generational health. I love that. We know that, man, I would say at least 6 months prior, maybe you say 12 months prior. How long do you think, you know, people need to start preparing, seriously preparing intentionally to conceive? I know some people have said 6 months. Some people believe it's a little bit longer.
So what I generally say is it's never too early and it's never too late, right? Which is like, if you, you know, are really jazzed about this and this is, you know, something that's important, you can start earlier. I usually recommend at least a year. But for some people, right, that's not practical. And so basically the sperm development cycle is just under 3 months. And the last stage of egg maturation is around 3 months. So at minimum, right, if you're making any changes in your lifestyle, you're going to need that minimum amount of time to start to see changes. And for many people, you may want a few of those egg development cycles or sperm development cycles to have the changes that you're making in your life be reflected, which is why I generally say like around a year. And I think it also allows people to change the way they engage with this period, which is, if I ask most people, like, would you rather spend time trying or preparing? Like, most people would say preparing, right? Because there's something pressure inducing once you start trying. And then we get kind of what you were talking about earlier, which is like timing sex and looking at, you know, all the metrics. And like, it's like the perfect desire killing, you know, combination of things. And so, you know, how do we get acquainted with our cycles? How do we understand whether we're ovulating or not? How do we upgrade our diet? How do we, you know, we didn't touch on this too much, but I know you guys have talked about this before. It's not only the foods that we eat, but it's the foods that we digest and assimilate that matter, right? So how do we make sure that the changes that we are making are being reflected into our bodies? And so that takes time. And, you know, and if you need to be doing a detox beforehand, or if you need to be managing your body fat percentage, and that is something that you desire to do, not someone else told you to do it, but if that is something you desire to do it, then it's important to do that away from conceiving, because in detox, compounds can get more potent, and a lot of toxins are actually stored in our fat cells. So those things need to be done away from conception. And so if those are on the docket for you, you feel like you have a particularly high toxin load, or you want to be conscious of your fat composition going into a pregnancy, then those are things that I encourage you to do in advance.
Yeah, I think that is such a good point to make. We often have clients that will come to us that want to conceive. And we usually advise, like, until we are done with this detoxification process or the gut work or anything, I do not recommend it, because it, like you said, you know, our babies can be miracles, but we don't want to risk the chance of something happening, increasing the chance of a miscarriage or something being wrong, obviously, God forbid, with the baby. And so, yeah, I think it's a huge piece to mention that it should be a very separate process of trying to heal the body or clean the body or detox and then trying to conceive. So let people know where they can find you, where they can find your book, and anything else that you want to share with our audience.
Oh, absolutely. So the book is called 9 Months Is Not Enough, and you can go to the website, the number 9 Months Is Not Enough. It's available on Amazon and kind of wherever you decide to go for your book purchases. It's available for you. And I actually just launched the audiobook last month. So for those of you that like to listen in audio, I'm a huge audiobook girly. So that's available for you as well. My business Poplin is at Get Poplin, both the website and the social media. So if you want to check out our testing and kind of the content that we have around the different categories of health and, you know, how we think about that, that might be a good resource as well. And we do have a promo code for your audience as well. So would love to support any of you who are interested in doing testing.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, we will definitely include all of that. Links in the show notes to everything. I love that you did the audiobook because I'm an audiobook girl too. Mm-hmm. I buy all the hard book, hard copy books, and then I'm like, oh, I haven't opened that one yet.
So I heard something interesting. I will just share that if you listen to an audiobook and read it at the same time, your retention is higher. So I've been experimenting with this recently, and it actually seems to be working. So I think there's something about like having a physical book. Like I like the feel, but for retention, especially like I'm walking, you know, walking around constantly and listening, it's a good tool, good hack. Yeah.
I'm sure that that's very true. And for me, I've taken like speed reading courses in the past. And so I'm sure if I was listening on Audible and then coming back to it and like speed reading through it and then being able to catch some of those snippets or clinical pearls and highlights, I'm a very like see it, apply it, like write it out type or highlight, you know, make my notes person for me to ingrain it. So thanks for that tip. I'll have to try it for sure. Awesome. The last thing that I would ask, and we ask this to every one of our podcast interviewees, if there was one thing that you had to shout from the mountaintop for the world to hear, what would that be?
I think it's that when we are sick, we focus inward. And when we are well, we focus outward on serving the world, sharing our gifts with the world. And I view it as our responsibility to help as many people as possible get well so that they can share their gifts. And I think that's a lot of what we do in this preconception period is helping future generations to be well so that they're not focused inward on themselves, but they're focused on contributing and building and being artists and entrepreneurs and musicians and all of these beautiful things that contribute to the world. I think that's a big piece of what drives me. And I think that's like the message that I hope other people take away, that health is so much more than just health. It has so many reverberations.
I love that.